Hello and welcome to the first episode of Time Flies with Killer Vibes. I'm your host, Pat O'Greer, and this is the monthly show where we recap and talk about everything that's going on in the metal rock alternative music scene. And I'm joined here by two great dudes from the music industry, the local Australian music industry, of course. First of all, we have independent music media specialist Craig Priest. Say hello, Craig.
Hey guys, what's up? I do Beers with the Band on YouTube. So I just interview bands pretty much. Hope you enjoy that.
Thanks, Craig. And obviously, secondly, we have fellow veteran muso, Dan Caulfield. Go, Dan.
Yep. Hey dudes and dudettes. I just play music, really. I do a couple of podcasts as well, Crow's Feet Choir. And yeah, just playing a few bands. I'm Atlas and Temporal Distortion and Die FM, if you ever want to have a look.
Only three.
And we'll certainly we'll be plugging those.
I overcommit.
As the show continues and the series continues. Thanks a lot for joining us, guys. And let's kick the show off. Our first segment of the show is what we like to call Blasting the Speakers. It's where we like to touch on top album releases of the month. And we just like to share our thoughts and views and what we thought about the particular albums that have come out. Is there anything that might have stand out to you guys? Dan, I'll throw it over to you.
Polaris stuff is pretty awesome. If you haven't heard them, go and check them out. They're a cool metalcore band. They've only been around for a couple of years, but they're like doing huge things. They toured with Northlane on their last tour, and that was, they're a special band to see, I think. And they'll be massive for the rest of the year, I think, as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm going to have to back you on that. Polaris are absolutely amazing. If you haven't checked them out, as you said, I would do as Shia LaBeouf would say, and just do it! There's no other way to describe it. You just have to go and check them out. I saw them when they toured the Dream on Dreamer recently, and it just blew my mind. Checked out the Casualties. If you haven't checked out the Casualties, I recommend doing it, because if you want some old school, like, I don't know, 80s, early 90s kind of punk, then they will be right up your alley.
I almost had a bit of Living End flavor thrown in when I was listening to them for the first time, actually, with the old school stuff.
Yeah,
even
nothing wrong with that.
Even the same dress sense as well.
Yeah, that's cool.
I think it's cool when a band has like that kind of uniqueness, and it's a bit different. It doesn't follow that same trend. Yeah,
it's definitely something that no one else is really, well, not too many people are doing at the moment.
Well, that's like the band Venomous Concept. I found that they've actually played shows with King Parrot when King Parrot were overseas. They were alongside a couple of shows with them, and they fall right in that same wheelhouse. Probably not as flat out heavy, but definitely that same drumming approach that King Parrot seemed to keep consistent with their songs. You can tell it's real. Just let's get pissed and wasted and listen to loud music kind of band.
Just smack in your face.
They actually did a I think it might be on the album as well, but there's a cover of a David Bowie song on the album, or at least it's on YouTube now as well. So,
and they've obviously put their own touch to it, obviously.
Definitely. But I've seen some comments against the video saying it's better than the original.
That's a huge call.
Some people may not like to hear that,
that's just the internet part. That's just like,
bringing into the new age, I suppose.
Whether they believe it or not, I think they just wanted to start a fight on YouTube.
That
doesn't happen on the internet. What are you talking about? All right, so let's move on to videos that have come out for the month. I guess this is a section of the show where we like to get all nice and sweaty about any exciting videos that have sort of caught the attention, caught the eye, anything that's been quite unique that's come out in the month of January. This particular month, ones that I've come across throughout my endeavours on Metal Ignition is The Devil You Know, which is a Nuclear Blast band. The video for Your Last Breath, it's a lyric video, just done in a slightly different way to your standard type of lyric video, where it's not just the words, but it is kind of does tell a story along with the lyrics. lyrics are animated quite well. The camera has a lot of good 3D movements and a lot of cool abstract sort of photography pictures thrown in the mix. It's quite a cool lyric video. Then we've got Sabaton, Resist and Bite, I think, which is a live video taken straight from their tour video, which is out March 4th through Nuclear Blast. I haven't actually had the chance to check it out. Have you checked that out yet at all, Craig? Did you get a copy of that?
No, I didn't get a chance to see that video, unfortunately.
So then Nuclear Blast have thrown that out to press contacts, and there is a way of viewing that, so I just have not had the opportunity yet. But kind of a band I'm not very familiar with, but they do seem to have a gigantic following, so certainly recommend to check it out. And then two particular animated lyric style videos, which I think are just crazy out there. Aversion's Crown, Erebus, I think is the correct pronunciation, which is follows their themes of aliens and whatever they think aliens do, and but it's some insane imagery. Very well, very awesome drawings. All of it, a lot of it is obviously digital art, I think, maybe not necessarily hand drawings, but really, really cool. And then,
What do they think aliens do? what were they doing in the video?
That's going to make me. I've never heard that band before ever, and that's going to make me go and watch that band now. just to see what
they're checking out. Give us a comment and let us know what you think is going on in their heads, or.
Yeah,
what aliens are doing.
I want to know.
But,
I know what aliens are doing.
The next one from Aborted, which has a very intriguing title, which is Vestal Disfigurement Upon the Sacred... Chantry?
Chantry.
Holy shit.
It's a mouthful. I don't even know what that is supposed to mean, but that is... Whatever yeah, is. That is a That's very, very brutal... and it plays homage to what I was talking about in our pre-show discussion, is pretty much an 80s horror poster.
Yep.
Sorry. Sick.
I'm going to shout it to my grandma, see if she likes it.
Yeah. You know, blood and guts and knives and girls
probably just running and monsters on with big tons.
Yeah, exactly.
If that's up your alley, check out that music video. And then just your standard sort of video, but I thought it was it's quite a cool song. It's got some good good imagery throughout it, which is the Bad Omens Exit Wound, which is a new Cimmerian Records band. I made the comment in our pre-show discussion is that they're Cimmerian Records' answer to Bring Me the Horizon, pretty much.
Which makes me want to check them out. I'm keen to check them out.
If you like the new Bring Me the Horizons sound, and even... their past album, Sepulternal, if you do like that album, I would recommend Bad Omens. They only have two songs released at the moment. There's not a lot of details you can find out about them. It's pretty much coming soon, but they have two music videos. But Exit Wounds is the most recent one, and definitely recommend to check that out. If you don't like the video, the song is really cool anyway. And just honorable mentions surrounding something a little bit more different that's come out for free on YouTube, which is in support of the live CD and DVD from Whitechapel, which is the Untold mini documentary, which is just a bit of behind the scenes stuff from tours. What do you guys reckon that's come out this month? Did you get a chance to check out any of those music videos I've mentioned?
I unfortunately didn't, but I definitely want to check out Bad Omens, Exit Wounds. You kind of got me hooked with the Bring Me the Horizon kind of sound. So I'm definitely going to check out that. I did check out Neck Deep. They've just released a new film clip that was actually filmed in Melbourne, Kali Ma. And yeah, it's kind of fun. So if you've ever been to Melbourne, or if you live in Melbourne, you'll notice some of the background scenes in that. And yeah, it's just typical Neck Deep pop punk style. But also saw Tonight Alive. They just released Drive. It's interesting. I'm not a huge fan of Tonight Alive by any means, but I just feel like she's turning into a bit more of a pop artist. I don't know if this is her or the record label, but they're trying to doll her up a bit. I mean, they're meant to be like a Paramore style band. Not that they're meant to be, but that's kind of how they're perceived.
What they're
and
shaping
then
into now.
Yeah, she's on a bus doing, like, she's got backup dancers and she's doing, like, choreographed dance moves. And I'm just like, oh, no.
Yeah.
What are you... I guess I think their label is Sony at the moment. So I don't know if they've got any kind of push or whatever, but, yeah.
Maybe she's always wanted to do a video like that, and that was the opportunity for her to do that. You know, those type of things can be plausible, but... I guess it really comes down to if you really hear the shift in the sound of the songs as well, is where you really start to get a bit concerned of that type of thing happening.
Yeah,
you have to be wary a little bit. Yeah, labels making money, trying to make more money. Yeah, maybe
someone's gonna make money.
Yeah, credibility. What? But no, I think is it Jenna? Is that her name?
Yeah, Jenna.
I think it is. Yeah, she's a super credible musician anyway, so I think like her fans will stick behind her regardless. But yeah, I think you might be onto something, Craig, with a record label maybe pushing her a little bit more just to do something a little bit more accessible.
Yeah, sure. Well, she's definitely looking smoking in that video, and I mean the video kind of is revolved around her, even though Tonight Alive are a band. I guess it's more the Jenna show than Tonight Alive.
And that's
but that's
when
always
she's just
be
like
place.
Objective
think
complete.
That's what's gonna happen. Oops.
Yeah. Well, it's their fault. They should have had an ugly lead singer, and then they probably would have focused more on the band.
God damn it, guys! That's the secret. Get an ugly bastard come, the fattest, ugliest bastard you can to come and sing for you.
Yeah.
We're gonna start eating Harvey Pies right now.
And you're gonna get the backup singers and all the backup dancers, and there's your video. And
yeah,
just make it happen.
Or it'll be the only film clip since Spider-Bait where it's just been the drummer the whole time.
And that ridiculous high frame rate, so it looks like he's having a buddy spaz the whole time. So, alright guys, so let's move on. It's now time to move on to a segment of the show we like to call Mosh Talks. This is where we'd like to recap on tours that have been announced for the month that's coming up. And also reflect on shows that we may have had the opportunity to jump on board of throughout the month of January. So let's have a bit of a look at what's going on this month. A couple of things that have dropped down our way in Australia: Stray from the Path. Some of these are side shows as well from Unify, so they fall into that category as well. So I guess I should say Unify obviously happened this month. It was a great success. It does hold a lot of good future for the heavy music scene for Australia, so I guess we have that to look forward to. We'll recap on that in a second. So Straight from the Path, Make Them Suffer, Radio Moscow and Kings Destroy, Confession, Horizon's Edge, Neck Deep, State Champs, Tonight Alive, Friends of Rom and Clowns, Dream on Dreamer, No Effects, Dead City Ruins, Nightwish, and Northlane. And some of those Northlane shows are falling over to this month and to February. And some of those tours may also, I think Tonight Alive, Craig, you mentioned earlier, I think might be falling over into the beginning of February also. Anything that you want to... I know that you mentioned that you went to a couple shows this month, Craig, so I'll throw it over to you.
Yeah, okay. Well, I saw Dream on Dreamer with and Polaris were supporting. I saw them at what's it called? Thank you, Liz.
The place.
I saw them at the Lair in Sydney, which was it was great. It was great. Dream on Dreamer did their thing, but I think I hate to say this because I do like Dream on Dreamer, but I feel that Polaris stole the show, even though they were the second last band on there. They just I couldn't pick my jaw up from the floor because it was just they just blew me away. I think that was the second time that I've seen them live. But yeah, Dream on Dream were doing their thing. It was good. They had a few people out there, probably not as many as they were hoping to get out there. The Lair's not the biggest venue, but I'm getting a little bit worried about Dream on Dreamer. I feel like they may be pushing it to their last album or coming up on their last album, unfortunately. I hate to say it because I think they're a good band.
Yep.
And they've done a lot for Australian for Australian music, I guess. They've toured the world. Yeah.
You've actually had some pretty interesting conversations with them on your channel, haven't you?
Yeah. I interviewed them a bit ago, and and they got... There's a talk whether they got dropped from Unified or if they left on their own accord, but yeah, there's a lot of... I had a great chat with them. If you go to Beers with the Band on YouTube and type in Dream on Dreamer, you'll see that the lead singer and the drummer at the time, he's now left, they actually had a big talk to me about what it's like to be with Unified and just labels in general and how much money that they actually suck from a local band. I know there's a lot of people out there that think that bands just get paid a lot of money and they constantly tour, but what they don't understand is bands that are touring the world can still have their own jobs. Like, majority of them still have their own jobs and they're still paying their way. I'm sure, Dan, you know this like anybody else.
Yeah, man.
It's so tough out there. It's got to be the hardest thing.
Did you guys see that? I don't know if you saw on the internet, probably your Facebook feed or something, but like the Clowns and the Friends of Rome show with that chick. I don't know if it was a guy or a girl, and he or she went to this. Do you know who it was? Like a guy or a girl?
No, it was a female, and she went to the show.
That's
and
right.
Hated it.
Yeah. But like, straight up asked for a cashback, and they're like, nah, doubt it.
Yeah, I like that. But apparently she saw the poster for the show, and she knew it was going to be rubbish, but she wanted to go there just to say that she went there and actually witnessed how rubbish it was. Like, she was going there knowing that she was going to hate it. What a fucking bitch. Sorry, can I say fuck?
Yes.
Are we saying fuck? We're saying fuck.
Yeah.
Paddy, are you saying fuck that?
Someone may or may not have said fuck.
Yeah,
there he is.
Well, she in my eyes is a fucking bitch. But then, hey, did Friends or Rom respond to her or something?
Yeah, it was awesome.
What was the response?
I think they responded by putting it on the internet, the whole thing. And her phone number and shit was on the thing and everything. Like, it was great.
Yes. That is perfect.
Wow.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Well, I also saw Neck Deep and State Champs. They were playing at the Metro in Sydney. I interviewed State Champs. I did a fan Q&A. So if you want to go to Beers with the Band, well, youtube.com/Beers with the Band, you can see that. They're good. If you like pop punk, you're going to love State Champs. They're a very professional band. You just can't fault them. I mean, the lead singer was Derek. Was Crook, like, he was really sick, couldn't do the interview because he had to rest his voice, and then he came out and you wouldn't have even known, like, he's just... And then I had a chat to him afterwards off camera, and he apologized for being sick and couldn't do it, and his voice sounded absolutely terrible, like he had the biggest blowout, but then when he got up and sang, you wouldn't even know. It's just they perform really, really well. State Champs, I only got to see a little bit, Neck Deep, I only got to see half of their set because I did get a little bit sourced up, and I ended up just sitting at the bar with my mate for the rest of the set.
How dare you?
That's great.
But they were fun. They were fun as well. With Confidence opened the whole show. I don't know if you've heard With Confidence before, but they're a fun band, and they're taking Australian pop punk to a whole new level. And watch out for those guys, because this year, 2016, is definitely going to be their year. I know that they've got a lot of things in the works. They just signed Hopeless Records, which is sick for them.
Same record label as Neck Deep and...
Yeah, Neck Deep, Trophy Eyes, and loads more. I think 4 Years Strong.
Is State Champs not on that as well?
No, I don't think State Champs are on that. They're too good for that, mate. They're too good for that.
They're
the only ones that I went to. I'm so gutted that I missed Stray from the Path, because their new album is just amazing, and I'm
so in love with that whole album. And Bullet and A Badge Part 2 blows my mind every single time. I've got it in my car, and it's just the greatest song I've ever heard.
Yeah.
It's just
There's
awesome.
A lot of bangers. D-I-E-P-I-G is great.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that's about how Front Doorstep, have you heard of Front Doorstep, and how he's been touching like underage girls, and it's all about
right, I have heard that, yeah,
pedophiles in the music industry. So because I guess that's been a thing now, like you've got Lost Profits guys gone to jail for it, Front Doorstep, Front Porch Step or something, and then Newfound Glory, Neck Deep, even they had one of their guys that they had to kick out because he, there was allegations running around. It's fucked anyway.
The fuck is wrong with people? But it's like, I don't know how, why.
I don't understand. They're getting girls thrown at them every time they play a show, like overage girls. Why do they choose the underage ones? I don't know. Anyway,
what's the plan? Yeah, I don't know. But yeah,
this just took a dark twist. This isn't the way.
It really did. Yeah. Now I'm depressed.
Yeah.
Cue scary horror music. Dun dun.
But what's coming up in February?
So coming up in February, there's some pretty awesome gigs coming up. We've got Soilwork, High Sick. On Fire, The Sword, 1349 or 1349, I'm not too sure how you're actually meant to say it. Between the Buried and Me, Funeral for a Friend, We the Kings, Truth Corroded, and Lagerstein. At least that's what I've been able to identify. If we've missed anything, please comment and let us know, and we'll address it in the next episode. But any of those that you guys are looking forward to, I know myself personally, I'm really hoping that I can get to the Soilwork gig. Last time I checked those guys out, I had the privilege of being able to film as well, and they're just an amazing band live, and they're a real happy metal band too, just grins on their faces the entire time. They thrive off each other and thrive off the crowd playing live, and they've been doing it for 20 just over 20 years now, so you'd expect nothing less. So plus the live lights at 170 Russell here in Melbourne just amplify it even more for a band like that. So certainly looking forward to that. And Between the Buried and Me would be a really great live experience. That they're the type of band that would, I've never seen them live, but I would recommend because they're very instrumental based band. They're not all instrumental, but they are very instrumental heavy.
Yeah,
and then obviously Funeral for a Friend, I think it's their final tour, and they're done and dusted. Tour. So if you are a big fan of Funeral for a Friend, I'd certainly recommend to try and pick up tickets for those shows. What about yourself, Dan? Anything that you're looking forward to or you recommend for fellow headbangers to grab a ticket for?
Yeah, I'd be the same as you, Pat. I'd be pretty tempted to go and check out Soilwork because I've never seen them before.
Yeah,
and that'd be a pretty amazing experience. I've seen Between the Buried and Me before. Definitely recommend. They're unbelievable. Definitely, if they're playing in an overage venue, which they will be, get a few drinks in and have a really good time with them.
Hell yeah! What about yourself, Craig? Have you got any tickets for any of these shows? Are you looking forward?
I don't. I haven't picked up a Funeral for a Friend ticket. That's one that I would like to, because the old emo Craig would just would have a heart attack, especially if they play some of their old songs.
Yeah,
I think they're playing. What's their? I think they're playing one of their albums front to back. I can't remember which.
Oh, they are.
Yeah, the one with
Casually Dressed, and I can't remember because that was 10 years ago.
Yeah, so that is one of their old ones then. That would have been back in 2006.
When they first really broke
something.
The scene, definitely.
So I'm going to probably try and go to that. I'm hooking up an interview with We the Kings, so let's hope that goes through, and then I'll be at that gig. Soilwork, I agree, I would love to check them out. And Lagerstein, if you... They're pirate metal, aren't they, or
pirate,
something?
Aussie pirate metal, yeah. So they recently Aussie toured with Ailstorm, which were here.
So they just drink beer and rum, right? That's just
their singer's name is like the Destroyer or something. Is that right?
I think they have a little character name.
How did that's you so not good. Go and see that band? I would love to go and see that band and just get like a jug of beer for myself and just stand there and watch it, just sipping it straight from the jug.
It would be disgusting. It would be so disgusting.
I'm pretty sure that type of action is actually part of their set. Correct me if I'm wrong. If any of you headbangers out there have seen these guys live, share your experience. We'd love to hear it in the comments below. Yeah. Another band that I did scout over before is Truth Corroded. They are a really great Perth band, I believe. Or Adelaide, I forget which place now, but they're an Australian metal band. They have been around for a fair while now. I did have the chance to catch them when I was checking out and filming and interviewing the band's escaping me now.
The Lagerstein, their album names are so good. They're so good.
Are you looking them up now?
yeah. Like Rum for All and just they're all about drinking. All their sub names and that's great.
Orpheus Omega. So I got the chance to see them when they were supporting Orpheus Omega's national tour. They are a kick-ass metal band, just through and through metal, and they are Australian, so I think this is the last lot of shows they're doing just before they go overseas again themselves. I believe they've been at least once or twice before in their career, going on a few years now, so I recommend them. They've definitely got a really good sound, just straight up metal. So
perfect.
The Rum Thieves, that's great. Beer Bong Song, Lagerstein, you gotta go see him.
Yeah.
I've gotta go see him.
So I want to go and see them before their liver gives out and they'll never be able to play.
Yeah. Goddamn cirrhosis, it's happening. Is that what it's called?
Well, I guess that's a good segue into
that'll be our last album, cirrhosis.
Good segue into our next segment of the show, which we like to call Straight Out Of, and Straight Out Of Brisbane is what we're highlighting this time around on this month. It's the time where we like to shine some light on some homegrown bands who are creating waves in the Aussie music scene. This month, Craig's taking the mantle, and we've got Straight Out of Brisbane. So who are we talking about this month, Craig?
She Cries Wolf. Great band from Brisbane. when you told me to pick a band, a local band to do it on... I can't get these guys out of my newsfeed on Facebook. Like, they are everywhere. They're just, if they're not posting something, then somebody else is posting something that they've done or talking about them in some way or another.
Wow.
They're absolutely amazing. I'll talk about their live show in a minute, but they're going to go on tour, on the Arsonist tour, which is going over March and April.
Yep.
And they're taking Stepson and Rat King with them. Stepson represent. I'm wearing this shirt. Stepson are a great band. I haven't heard Rat King, but She Cries Wolf are just, if you haven't seen them live, you should need to go see them on tour in March and April, because this is something that I want to talk to you guys about. This is what they do at their live set. Tell me if you think that this is okay or not. But you know how people circle pit and people kind of punch each other when there's when there's some fast music going, breakdowns and all that. So what these guys do is they never play on stage. I think it's only the drummer that ever stays on stage, and they encourage people to just punch and kick them throughout the whole show. So you've got the guitarist just there, somebody's pulling his hair while another person is just smacking him in the stomach. And he's trying to play guitar, and then somebody else comes up and will just kick the lead singer in the leg, and then it is complete and utter mayhem. I don't know, what do you guys think about this? Because some people get scared, like some people aren't going to shows anymore, even though they love the hardcore music, they love the metal music, but they're scared that they're going to get punched in a pit. What do you say to bands that are encouraging this kind of violence at shows? Do you think it's a good thing? Do you think it's a bad thing? Because I'm okay for hardcore dancing, but then what I don't like is the people that start swinging their arms when they're right next to the edge of the circle, when there could be a female there, there could be, even if there's a male that it gets an unsuspecting punch to the face. Just because you're on the edge of the pit doesn't mean you want to be involved in the pit. Like, I don't know. Yeah. What's your take on it?
Just watching.
Yeah.
You want to go first,
Pat? So these guys are obviously encouraging all that kind of...
Yeah.
I might be wrong, but these guys, they sound very similar. Because I remember I've heard them on Triple J a couple of times. Do they sound very similar to Cancer Bats?
Yeah.
A little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
that's about...
Yeah, definitely. That sounds like raw, rawness. Good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are very
good
raw.
Fucking good sounding band.
I think they're an amazing sound.
Yeah, look, I don't know. Pretty much the way I see it is similar to you, Craig. Like, as long as you're not explicitly trying to inflict harm to someone. The way I like to experience mosh pits, as long as everyone's sort of having a good time and everyone is actually looking out for each other, and yeah, being mindful of those handful of ones that just want to stand in the middle and throw their arms and legs everywhere, and if you get in my way, well, then you're in trouble. Those kind of people I do always frown upon, because yeah, you do get the occasional harmless person that might accidentally get the cop to the nose, and there goes the rest of their night, sort of thing. And I mean, I'm not even really one for crowd surfers either. You know, I'm a bit old school when it comes to it all. So I mean, I just like to be able to go bro to bro sort of thing, and just jump around, jump together, and a bit of pushing and shoving, and maybe a circle pit run around like an idiot and push a couple of people that are doing that. But as far as the hardcore dancing, it does draw lines in the crowd of shows and can ruin a lot of people's experiences, I find. I mean, the most recent sort of memory I can think, which I could definitely see that happening, and it did just cause an entire space for the rest of the gig for no other reason, because two people were being idiots, which was during Make Them Suffer gig down at Next in the bottom floor. And yeah, because two people decided they wanted to do that, then everyone had to be like up against the wall, and until finally maybe some other people sort of got the flow going back again. But then as soon as someone decides to throw their arms and legs around, you're back to square one, and I just find that it can ruin the experience a lot of the time. But
yeah,
I mean, I could rant on about that situation for a long time. What about you, Dan?
Oh man, my it fucking makes me angry. Yeah. Like, metal music is, as much as it's exclusive, it's got to be inclusive as well of everyone. So that's the whole point. That's why I started to like metal, because it was like, it didn't matter who you were or what you did or what you wore. You could be the shyest little prick from the shortest little weakest dude, but still love metal. Like, look at me. I'm like, by the way, I'm like 5 foot. You know, I'm not tall or muscly or any of those things. And if I'm standing at the back of a crowd and someone's swinging their fist and their legs and hits me, that could ruin the rest of my night, you know, and probably 10 people crap out of that guy. It's just a vicious cycle. I think you keep it to yourself, keep your hands to yourself, like do your dancing and stuff, and be respectful, otherwise fuck off.
I think that's exactly the best way to put it.
Or pick on someone your own size. Pick on someone your own size if you want to.
Yeah, exactly. Like, they've got all this room here. Like, I've seen some people just run to the edge of the pit and then do a cartwheel right when they get to, when they're right next to somebody, just so that they can purposely kick them in the face. And I'm like, that is just absolute ridiculous. That's assault.
That's just being a fuckwit. Fucking hell.
Actually, reminds me of a story of when my brother and best mate went to see Parkway Drive back in old Parkway Drive days.
Oh man,
so must have been smoking when you got it.
That's when that all started.
That's exactly
goddamn
right.
Parkway Drive,
and it was like literally like 10 seconds into the first song, and my mate copped a punch to the eye, like just standing there, didn't even know where it happened, and instant black eye for like the rest of the night.
So, that's bullshit. Yeah.
it's just not good for anyone. Well,
in She Cries Wolf defense, maybe they're taking away from that by they're saying come and punch and kick us so that they don't hurt anybody else. Maybe that's the bright side of it. But anyway, back to She Cries Wolf. You should check them out. They've got an EP out called Chapter 2. That's out now, and they've actually signed to 11th Records, which is the record company that Troy, ex-Amity Affliction guitarist, has started. So he started that up as soon as he left Amity Affliction. He wanted to start his own thing, and so he started 11th Records, and She Cries Wolf, I think, were one of the first bands that he signed. So yeah, definitely keep an eye out for them in March and April, and go see a show, because they're headlining that, and that's going to be a big deal for them to go on their first national headlining tour.
Absolutely.
So more people the merrier. And if you want a punching bag, use them as a human punching bag, I guess, because they're all for it.
Free workout, like,
save cash,
workout and everything. And all they charge you is admission fee.
The admission fee might start going up with the hospital bills.
All right, excellent. Well, we'll certainly make sure we add all the links about the bands that we talk about in the Straight Outta section. So this month it was Straight Outta Brisbane, She Cries Wolf. So make sure you guys check them out. Let us know what you think. If you have been to a show and you have punched them in the face, leave a comment. We'd love to know if they went, ow!
Or if they said, give me more.
Yeah.
That's not how you punch. No. This is how you punch. So let's move on to the last segment of the show. We'd like to call this part Legendary Tunes. This is just our feeling old segment almost, where we like to discuss a band or an album that is celebrating an anniversary this year or this month or whatever it might be. So 10 or 20 year anniversary is what we're aiming for. This particular month, we're going to touch on Atreyu, Death Grip on Yesterday. So this album came out... I think it was May or March in 2006. I think it might be May. Now, I'd already been listening to Atreyu a fair bit prior to that. Certainly, it's had a lot of spins in my playlists over the years, and I think the main drive... Sorry, Craig?
I just said Suicide Notes and Butterfly Kisses for Life.
Oh, man. Definitely.
I just find that the drum recording on that album is really crisp, really fine. And as a drummer myself, I really appreciated that album in that way, because it did finally provide the drummer a little bit more. He was sort of stepping out of his comfort zone a little bit more. I found trying new different styles of riffs, fills, to make the drumming a lot more creative and not being so restricted because he has to sing. The song structures are exactly the same as always. But I guess it was even the first introduction on that album where their screamer, and forgive me, I don't know their names, but he started to blend different approaches. It wasn't just screaming into the microphone. It was actually a bit of talking, a bit of different vocal delivery. You might be able to comment a little bit more further, Dan, there being a vocalist yourself.
Yeah. Alex, I'm just looking up on Wikipedia-ing that right now to see what his name is. But yeah,
excellent.
Alex, yep,
try
okay.
Try his last name, because it's so hard.
Oh, fuck. Alex Vakatara. No, no idea, man, no idea. Barkatzas. Vakatas. Oh, that's right.
Let's just call him Alex.
Cool. That was easy. Vakatas. I got it.
Yeah.
Wasn't as hard as I thought. Yeah, so say again what you're saying, Pat. That bass vocals again.
So yeah, pretty sure he has like different vocal delivery throughout that album. Yep. It was sort of like the first time where he started doing a little bit more than the previous ones.
Yeah. I think he had some more like some different tones, I think he used. Which just happens when you've been screaming forever and you've been doing like hundreds of gigs and whatever. But yeah, man, that album wasn't an album that I listened to heaps. The album before that, which was with Bleeding Mascara on it, which was just like friggin'
the
huge.
The Curse.
That was an album that I smashed. Man, I don't know enough about that album to even comment on it, to be honest.
Yeah, right, okay.
I'm the worst person to ask. Sorry.
What about you, Craig?
Back in the day, I guess, Suicide Notes was great. The Curse was great. And then when it got into this album, I feel like Alex, as Dan said, was getting a little bit bored and wanting to kind of venture out into something else. He was probably getting vocal training as well, and was wanting to learn how to sing and use his voice in other ways. And he started to do that. And I noticed that he started to do that, and it really pissed me off. Because I was like, you're a fucking screamer, just scream. Don't try and get all technical. Don't try and be all fancy with your voice, because all I want to do is want to hear these clean sings, the clean vocals from the drummer, and then the harsh screams from the vocalist.
That's right.
And that was when I started to lose interest in Atreyu. It was that song. Because like the song that they brought out with X's and O's, I think is... That was where it had a lot of singing in it, and it was a lot of singing from Alex as well in that song.
Yeah.
And he'd never really done that before. And it just made me cry. It made me cry. but the problem is now, I've been listening to that since you told me it's been 10 years and we were going to talk about it on this show. I've been cranking it, And I really like it now. Like, I think this album is amazing.
Yes.
I think now that I guess I've grown up a lot as well, I can understand why they were wanting to write a bit differently, and maybe because they were maturing as musicians. And I think it shows in that album. It's a top album.
Definitely.
And I can't believe it's 10 years old, because that's insane.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's briefly after high school for me, really, that album. When I really started to appreciate music even more because of all the extra free time. Well, not really. Stay in school.
That's when I appreciate Xbox a lot more.
But I mean, my favorite song, if we have to call out favorite songs on that album, is definitely We Stand Up. It grabs you by the balls straight away at the start of that song with the awesome drum fill, and it's just fast paced, heavy hitting, that song. But yeah, there are a couple of other songs where things chill out a little bit more, like that X's and O's song, Untitled Finale almost as well. But there are some pretty epic songs on there. But probably for me, I think Lead Sales Paper Anchor, the 2007 album, for me is probably my favourite Atreyu album.
Really? That was when I really stopped listening.
Yeah. You see, I didn't enjoy the recording of The Curse. It just really did not sit well with me. It was too messy sounding, and the drums just weren't clean and crisp enough like they are on the A Death Grip on Yesterday. So I guess that's what sort of made me sort of forget that other album and just listen to that one. I mean, sure, I'd pull out Right Side of the Bed every now and then, and what's the other one, The Crimson, and Bleeding Mascara. But even then, it's kind of like, sort of skip it off a little bit and just chuck on We Stand Up.
I think because you listen to that album so many times probably as well. Like, I listened to that album, it must have been like every day for like 2 years. Like,
yeah,
it was a lot. It was that and Funeral for a Friend. That's what it was. It was those two albums. Yep. And The Used came out at that same sort of time. And 36 Crazy Fist, Bitterness, no. Is it Bitterness the Star?
Bitterness the Star.
36, no, the one after that. I'm looking at the poster behind you, Pat, End of Heartache, and it was the same era as that.
It was a Snowcapped Romance.
Snowcapped Romance, thank you. My favourite album of all time, and I can't remember the name of it. That's fantastic. But yeah, that era of of whatever that was, like, it was, I guess it was metal. It was new metal? Was
new
it new metal?
Metal almost, yeah. Was the term being thrown emo, new metal. In those years, yeah.
Yeah, oh, good think, years.
When,
it was great. It was great.
Roadrunner Records were on fire at that time.
Everything I owned was from Roadrunner Records.
Yeah.
Like, my whole...
Yeah.
God, everything.
Yeah, it was like the record label where you didn't even have to know what the band sounded like, but if they were signed to Roadrunner, you would just have a listen to them or buy their album anyway.
Yeah,
it really did.
All right, guys. Well, I think that's about calls it a day for us on this episode of Time Flies with Killer Vibes. Thank you for joining us. If you like this video, please feel free to give us a nice big thumbs up, share the video, comment below. We'd love to hear all your thoughts about all the discussion that we've had this month, and this is an ongoing monthly show, so catch us again on the next show around about the end of the month of February. And I'll just throw it out to you guys as well. Dan, where can people find you online?
Yeah, if you just even just Google search, it's Die FM. Just to find out the music that I do. Otherwise, you can add me on Instagram, which is Justin Bieber's Vagina. So just hit that up. You'll see some random dumb shit. So
there is no way your Instagram tag is Justin Bieber's Vagina.
I've been under constant scrutiny from my girlfriend to change it, because she owns a lolly shop, and so she's posting this stuff to kids. Like, and she's gonna like tag me in Justin Bieber's Vagina. It's so good. So good.
I'm looking that up right now. I have to.
You had to ask, though, Pat. You had to ask.
Yeah. Well, you had to say it.
Yeah.
Awesome. So thanks, Dan. Yeah, make sure you guys check out his band. We'll plug out. We'll put some plugs in the comments below. Die FM's. What does Die FM stand for, Dan?
It stands for Does It Even Fucking Matter.
There you go. Bam. Yep. Best band name ever.
Oh.
Craig, over to you. Where can people find you online?
As I said before, the big one, I'd love it if you could hit subscribe on youtube.com/beerswiththeband. I just pretty much sit down and have beers with the band. It's amazing. You can hit me up on Facebook, also Beers with the Band on Facebook. And Twitter and Instagram is Beers with the Band, but it's spelled B-R-S with the band. Because they wouldn't let me fit it. Beers in it's too long.
Beers, no? Awesome. Thanks, guys. Thank you very much for joining us on the panel today, guys. You'll see these guys again as our series continues. And we'd like to give you guys another shout-out. Thanks very much for joining us. I'm Pato. You can find me on all the social media networks, just Metal Ignition at everything. Be sure to subscribe to the channel, and we'll see you next time on the next episode of Time Flies of Killer Vibes right here on